I am starting the recording button. Yeah, so I'm just sharing the screen so you can see what I want to say and why it is required and so on. Huh? So before going to the details of volatility models, I'm just giving you some examples such that you can understand why it is required. So in time series model, if you have any question, you can parallelly ask me. So in time series model, what we have done, can you tell me in univariate time series model, what we have done? Hello? Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, in univariate time series model, we have basically doing some time series model like a stationary time series model like ARMA model, say AR model, MA model, and ARMA model to do only two things. One is forecasting the model. Another one is controlling the model or controlling the data generating process, right? Now, sometime what we are seeing that we are the economic agents are not interested to forecast the label values. Even if they are interested to forecast the label values, but parallelly they want to measure certain risk. As for example, say if you have some stock market data, then your primary focus is on forecasting return as well as to measure risk, because suppose you are an investor and you want to invest some money to certain assets. So now suppose you have zero return at time period T. So then, or any constant return at time period T, then if you want to diversify your portfolio, then what you will see, you will look into the risk of that asset. Okay. So if risk is low, then you will invest in that particular asset. If risk is high, you will not invest in that particular asset. Right. Similarly, in case of say let inflation, there is one concept called inflation uncertainty. Okay. So suppose inflation at time period T is 5% and you have forecasted that inflation in the next period is also 5%. But there may be some inflation uncertainty. So forecasting means on an expectation you are saying that inflation will be 5%. But there will be certain fluctuations around the mean value. So now if the fluctuation is very high, then you will face certain uncertainty. Accordingly, your decision will change. So if you forecast that in the next period, your volatility or inflation uncertainty is very high, you don't know what will happen, but on an average, the expected value is 5%, but the fluctuation level is very high. Then the economic agent will take certain decision compared to when fluctuation is very low. So sometimes we are not interested to see the label values only. Sometimes we are interested to focus on the fluctuation, or in economics term, what we are called it, say risk or uncertainty, right? So in that case, to measure risk or uncertainty, we have to have certain model which calculate the level of uncertainty or level of volatility. So by volatility is the statistical term. If we say translate it into economics term, then we will say that it is either risk or uncertainty, right? Now, yeah, any question? Hello. No question. Okay, fine. So, So I am taking one example of stock market, thus that it will be better to understand. So in stock market also, when investors are investing, they are focusing on return as well as risk. So an investor can invest in a particular asset when the risk is low, right? If I compare two or three assets, then I will invest on those particular assets where risk is low comparatively. Now the question is, how to measure risk? Do you have any idea how can I measure risk? Yeah. So standard deviation can be considered as a measurement of risk, right? Now the problem with standard deviation or variance is that given the T number of observation, we can calculate only one standard deviation or only one variance. And we will assume that the standard deviation or the variance is fixed for all time, right? So the unconditional variance or unconditional standard deviation, unconditional, that what you know about the definition of standard deviation or variance, that is called unconditional variance or unconditional standard deviation. So that is fluctuation from mean value. So in that case, we are assuming that risk or uncertainty or variance, it is fixed for all time period. But if we think about stock market, or if we think about say inflation, we are feeling that risk is not fixed for all time. Is it okay? So sometime you are saying that market is very risky, or sometime you are saying that market is not that risky. So the meaning is that risk is not fixed for all time period. So in that case, if we consider standard deviation or variance as a measurement of risk, that will not be an appropriate measure. Any question? Okay.
Mama, aku book malay ko English book ma.
So
please mute the audio.
Mama, English book malay ko la. Baba.
Someone is there, no? Child, okay. So we can measure time varying risk by using some other measures of uncertainty. So I am just sharing the screen so that you can understand it. So here I believe that standard deviation can be of risk. Now another important thing called realized volatility, which we can use as a measure of time varying risk. In that case also you have certain limitation. I am coming to that point. So suppose you are interested to measure risk for the monthly frequency, but you have the data which is daily basis, right? So if I want to measure stock market risk or inflation uncertainty for the month of January, and suppose I have inflation data in the daily frequency, then in the month of January I have 31 observation. Or if you just say leave the holidays, then you will have at least 22 observations. Taking this 22 observation, I can strike one standard deviation or one variance, right? So So this can be considered as the measurement of risk or uncertainty for the month of January, right? So this sigma is equal to rho over t summation ri minus mu square. This is the measure of uncertainty or risk, or it is basically a variance of standard deviation for the month of January. Similarly, we can compute it for February, March, April, and so on. And in this way, we can compute the measurement of uncertainty for different time periods. Okay. But the restriction is that in that case, if you want to measure the probability or risk for the month of January, then you have to have higher frequency data. So this measurement is called real risk volatility. Other kind of volatility measurements are also there. The next measurement is called conditional volatility. Yeah, any question?
Sir, actually your voice is not coming clear because of one participant, Galaxy A30.
Yeah.
Galaxy A30.
Who is Galaxy A30? Please request. Yeah. Okay. So now the next question is, conditional volatility. And in your syllabus, this part is only there, right? So we will, in your syllabus, when we are doing volatility, we will not go to some other measures. We will only focus on conditional volatility, or the name of this conditional volatility is called autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity or generalized autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity. Now, what is this conditional volatility? Conditional volatility is the measurement of variance or standard deviation when you have the information set up to period t minus 1. So if I want to measure variance of say stock return at time period t, then we have the data and all information about the data till time period t minus 1. Now if we see that the variance is autoregressive, that means there is huge correlation or high correlation in the variance, autocorrelation in the variance, then from the past variance I can calculate the present variance. The measurement of volatility in this way is called conditional volatility. Now, from the statistical point of view, when you have some data, you can see certain observations. These observations, I want to tell you, just focus on the slide I have shared. That is, say, some simple eye observation, right? So if you have data, then you can see that if you plot the data, you can see that the plots of all indices show that volatility clustering means what? That is, say, suppose follow this graph. This is a stock market return of S&P 500. That means stock market return of the index of NYSE, New York Stock Exchange. Here you can see that if we plot the data, it is stationary process. It is a mean reverting process. Mean is constant around zero. But sometime you can see that there is high fluctuation. Sometime there is low fluctuation, right? So from 2003 to 2007, you are seeing that there is low fluctuation. But from 2007 to 2010 or 2009, you can see that there is high fluctuation. So sometimes you have low fluctuation and sometimes you have high fluctuation. So this is called volatility clustering. So if you see the data, sometimes you can have these types of picture, and this is the hint or hint that there is some volatility clustering, and in that case you have to do certain volatility measurement. Now another characteristics of high frequency financial or macroeconomic data is that large fluctuation or large shock is followed by another large shock. That means if at time period T there is high fluctuation, in the next period also you are expecting a high fluctuation. Now suppose for any random shock, sometime after there is a low fluctuation, then in the next period also you will see that there is another low fluctuation or low shock. So what does it mean? That means the variance is basically autocorrelated. Another thing is that you can have lot of, your connection is unstable. Okay, so are you hearing me? Because my internet showing that there is low poor connection. Are you hearing me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So if you see the data, you can see that lot of observations are at the tail. What does it mean by this? It means, so are you seeing this one? So I am drawing one picture. If you are not seeing it properly, then you can ask me. So suppose you have some stock market return, say R1, R2, up to RT, R capital T. Are you seeing this? Hello?
Yes.
Yeah. So now suppose you are plotting these things, you are drawing a histogram, or you are fitting it as a normally distributed curve, right? So in that case, your distribution will be like this, assuming normality. But sometime you can see that if you draw some distribution, say let you are drawing some empirical distribution using kernel density function and so on, you can see that there are large number of observation in the tail. Large number of the observation in the tail, right? So there will be large number of observation in the tail. That means you will have some observations, say let -25, -30 and so on. These are the stock return, and sometime you will have, say, too many observations which are +30, +25 and so on. Okay. So that means if your distribution is around zero, that means the mean value is zero, then you can see in case of stock market that large number of observations are, say, high positive values, and large number of observation has high negative value. So this is called the thick tail property or excess kurtosis. That means the kurtosis of this data is more than 3, right? So this is another important observation. This is another important observation for high frequency financial data. Now the next observation is that the data are positively skewed. So you have certain skewness in the data. So as per I have said that there are large number of observation in the tail, or this is called fat tail or thick tail properties of the data. So this is called excess kurtosis, high kurtosis or excess kurtosis. The kurtosis is more than 3. And you can see that the Jacques-Beran normality test suggests that the distributions are not normal. Obviously, if the kurtosis is very high, so it will be not normal, because in case of normal distribution, you know the kurtosis value is 3. So if you have fat tail distribution, that means the data is not normal. And sometime higher order moment, that means fourth order onward, higher order moments may not exist if you have these types of fluctuations. Now, yeah, any question? Now another important characteristics is that returns are not autocorrelated. Suppose you have done one autoregressive moving average model. Obviously, your primary focus is to say remove the autocorrelation from the error term. So you are taking such a model such that there is no autocorrelation in the error term. So in the error term there is no autocorrelation, but squared return or squared error term may be autocorrelated. That means if you take the if you do some say ARMA type model, or assume that the mean is constant at some mu values at some mu, then error terms are not autocorrelated. But if you just compute the squared error term and do the same autocorrelation test, you can see that there is autocorrelation in the squared error term. So these are certain simple eye observation from the data when you have high frequency time series data. Now what is the implication of these observations? The implication is that you have nonlinear dependencies. You have nonlinear dependencies in the data generating process. Now, if your higher order moments does not exist, then you have some serious statistical problem related to statistical inference. Okay, and if you have thick tail, that means if you have excess kurtosis, then this excess kurtosis has great implication to measure value at risk. So what does it mean by value at risk? Value at risk is, say suppose you have this data, and you have given the data. An investor is asking you to draw the to fit a distribution, and just let him know that what is the probability that the return from an asset will not fall below a certain specified value. So suppose I am an investor and I can tolerate minus 10% return. But I will not tolerate less than this return. Okay, so suppose it is a normally suppose you as a statistician you fit a normal curve, and if this is say let minus 10%, what is the probability that my return will fall below 10%? This is basically this area, right? This area. Okay, now if you have a fat tail property, if you have a fat tail property of the data, and you are, if as a statistician you are fitting a normally distributed curve, then obviously when you are measuring value at risk, you are doing some wrong measurement. So suppose your data generating process looks like this. Suppose the actual distribution is in the red line. This is my actual, and this is blue one is normal. Okay, suppose the red one is actual data generating process, and you have fitted the blue line, that means the normal, assuming normal distribution. So if you measure the value at risk, that means the my return will not fall below 5%, below 10%, minus 10%. So if you assume that the data is following normal distribution, then to compute value at risk, you are doing certain wrong calculation. So in case of fat tail property, if you are not addressing the thick tail or excess kurtosis, your value at risk measurement is wrong, right? So these are certain implication of the data generating process when you have volatility clustering. Okay, now what is our goal? Our goal is to model the time series data such that we can address these issues. What are these issues? the issues are factorial property and nonlinear dependencies. Okay, so nonlinear dependencies and factorial properties, these two we want to address, right? So we will address this issue by considering a autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity model given by Robert Angel in 1982, and for this paper Robert Angel got the Nobel Prize in 2003 along with Lord Clive Granger, okay, who has given a model on cointegration. So now I am going to the class notes where the volatility models are given. So what is this volatility model or autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity model? The model is like this. So suppose you have a stationary time series RT that is returned from certain asset, and these RT can be modeled as mu t plus epsilon t, where mu t is any adapted model for the conditional mean. So the mu t can be following say autoregressive model or moving average model or ARMA model, or you can have some other x variables also. So mu t is any adapted model, and RT can be written as mu t plus epsilon t. Now we want to model the volatility. So epsilon t is following a normal distribution. Epsilon t, given the information set up to t minus 1, it is following a normal distribution with mean mu and with mean 0 and variance sigma t square. In other words, I can write epsilon t is equal to sigma t into et, where sigma t is the standard deviation, conditional standard deviation, and et is iid normal with mean 0 and variance 1. Now what is sigma t? Sigma t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 into epsilon t minus 1 plus alpha 2 epsilon t minus 2 plus alpha p epsilon t minus p. That means I am saying that the volatility or the conditional variance given the information set up to t minus 1 is depending on past p number of error terms. Okay, so given the error term up to t minus 1, I can compute the conditional variance at time period t. And the underlying model is like this: sigma t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 epsilon t minus 1 square up to alpha p epsilon t minus p square. This means that when I want to measure the risk at time period t, I will just look into the past error term square or past squared error term. So if my variance or conditional variance is depending on past p number of squared error term, then I can calculate the standard deviation or variance at time period t. So as I have all this information about the error term till t minus 1, I can compute the variance or standard deviation or the measurement of risk for time period t. Please mind it that here I am assuming that this et is following iid normal with mean 0 and variance 1. So in other words, I can write epsilon t I can write epsilon t given psi t minus 1 is equal is following normal with mean zero variance sigma t square. Look into this. Epsilon t given psi t minus 1, that is given all the information set, it is following a normal distribution with mean zero. Obviously it is error term, so mean will be equal to zero, and variance is sigma t square, not sigma square, sigma t square. That means variance is changing over time, and the way it is changing, that is given in the equation, right? Equation number 7.4. So last time I told you that it is addressing the excess kurtosis, right? Excess kurtosis. So kurtosis for the normal distribution, kurtosis for the normal distribution is 3, but here I am assuming that it is conditionally normal. So obviously you can ask some question that if we are also assuming it is normally distributed, then why are we are saying that it will address the excess kurtosis? That we will look in the next page, that given that we are assuming that epsilon t is conditionally normal, but if we take the unconditional distribution of epsilon t, it will follow or it will capture the excess kurtosis. So kurtosis for the Gartz model, kurtosis for the Gartz model is more than 3, right? So in the next page we can see that just 1 minute. Yeah, autocorrelation. Yeah, kurtosis, right? 7.2.13. Here we are showing that kurtosis value for the Gartz model is greater than is equal to 3. That means it is addressing the issue of fractal, right? It is addressing the issue of fractal. Though we are assuming that it is conditionally normal. So now coming to the properties of this Gartz model. Properties of the Gartz model is that its unconditional variance is fixed for all time, and that can be computed as omega divided by 1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2 minus alpha p. So you can look into the simple calculation. So as you know something about time series, it will be very easy to compute for you. So if I assume that the conditional variance is changing over time, but if I take expected value of the conditional variance, it will be the unconditional variance, and which is fixed for all time, right? So if we consider, hello.
So,
hello. Meeting is going on, no? It will be for 30 minutes, I think. So I am resending one link. Yeah, I'm resending one link, and you can click on it. Because it is a free version, and it is allowing only 30 minutes as per I am seeing. Yeah, so it is going on. So let. Hello. Yeah.
10 minutes we have right now.
How much? It is for 12:05.
More than 10
already
minutes,
12:12, right? Okay, let's go. If it stop, then I will again sending you some link, and you can join. Okay. Okay, fine. So now I'm not going to the details of the calculation. All are given there. So I'm just, as you have to submit some projects. So I'm just going for some discussion on how you can do these things and what is the meaning of it and so on. So the properties are the conditional variance is fixed, unconditional variance is fixed for all time, and the autocorrelation coefficient for the error term is similar to the AR1 process. So if we assume that it is an ARCH1 model, that means sigma t square is following only, say, is depending on only one error term, then you can easily show that epsilon t square is following simply an AR1 model, where epsilon t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 epsilon t minus 1 square plus vt. So here we are assuming that sigma t square is depending only on one leg of the squared error term. So in that case, we can show you that epsilon t square is following a simple AR1 process, where vt is the white noise process. Vt is the white noise process, and this vt is called the volatility shock. So whenever I am saying you that volatility is autocorrelated or conditional variance is autocorrelated such that a large fluctuation is followed by another large fluctuation, that means if today volatility is high, next day also volatility will be high or higher than this, then when it will become low, that is depending on the volatility shock. So sometime due to certain shock, your volatility may be low, and in that case your next period volatility will be again low. So this vt term, you can show that this vt term is following white noise process, and this is called the volatility shock. So as epsilon t square is following say AR1 process, so obviously the first order autocorrelation of epsilon t square will be alpha 1, and sth order autocorrelation will be alpha 1 to the power s, as it is given in the AR1 process. Now coming to the measurement of kurtosis. So you can see the derivation given here at 7.a, that the excess kurtosis in case of ARCH model is greater than 3. So that means it is addressing the fat tail property. Now the question is, why we will compute this GARCH model? So if you are an investor and you want to forecast, or if you want to measure the risk at time period t, and you want to forecast the future risk as well, then you can take GARCH or ARCH model to forecast the volatility or the risk of the stock market. Now Bolotsleff in 1986 generalized this ARCH model, and the name of this model is called generalized autoregressive conditional heteroscedasticity. What does it mean by this generalization? Now you know that in case of AR1 model, if the AR1 number of AR1 coefficient is very high, that means RT is depending on so many lag values, then we can have some parsimonious model, say ARMA 1-1 model, which essentially captures the higher order AR model. Similar to this, here also we are bringing the idea of ARMA model. If in case of ARCH model your number of parameters are very high, that means if sigma t square is depending on say p number of lag values, and the p is very high, that means you have to estimate too many coefficients, then we can borrow the idea of ARMA model such that the same data generating process can be captured, through a less number of parameters. So if we consider a simple GARCH model, so here you can see that sigma t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 epsilon t minus 1 plus beta 1 epsilon sigma t minus 1 square. So obviously beta 1 sigma t minus 1 square is the autoregressive part, and alpha 1 epsilon t minus 1 square is the moving average part. So it is similar to the ARMA model, right? It is similar to ARMA model. Now we can show you that if we replace sigma t minus 1 square, then finally we can write sigma t square as infinite order arch process. So an infinite order arch process or a higher order arch process can be written as a lower order Garth model. So the idea of Garth model is to give a parsimonious model which is basically equivalent to a higher order Garth model, as similar to AR model, higher order AR model and low order ARMA model. Okay. Now we will go to the estimation procedure, but before that we want to discuss some other Garth models and the limitation of simple Garth model. In the simple Garth model, you have certain limitation. You have certain advantage that given the t number of observation, you can calculate t number of conditional variance. That means you can calculate time varying risk. But the limitation is that in case of Garth model, the volatility is symmetric. Symmetric in the sense that if you have positive shock or negative shock at time period t minus 1, the contribution of this shock is same. That means suppose you have a arch model or Garth model where at the last time period, that means at time period t minus 1, you have a positive shock, then the contribution of this shock to compute the conditional variance at time period t is alpha 1 into epsilon t minus 1 square as per the Garth equation. So if you have a positive shock, the contribution of that shock is same as if you have a negative shock. But in reality, if you look at the investor's behavior, then you can see that if there is a positive shock, then investor's behavior, and if there is a negative shock, then investor's behavior, these two are not same. In case of a negative shock, investors are doing investors are creating some noise such that the volatility will be higher at time period t. So that means the contribution of t minus 1, if epsilon t minus 1 is not same if there is a positive shock and if there is a negative shock. In case of negative shock, investors' behaviors are such that it will create more noise and consequently more volatility. So positive shock and negative shock has some asymmetric contribution to calculate volatility at time period t. So this is not captured in the simple Garth model. And the hypothesis and the idea that the volatility will be higher in case of a negative shock is called leverage effect hypothesis. So if you want to check whether in a stock market there is leverage effect or not, you cannot capture this through a symmetric arch model or Garth model. Okay. So, in that case, what we will do, we will have some other models. We will have some other models which captured the positive and asymmetric of the asymmetric relation of positive and negative shock. Another thing is that in case of Garth model, in case of arch or Garth model, when I am writing that say simple arch model, come to simple arch model, Just 1 minute. Yeah. So sigma t sigma bar square is equal to omega by 1 minus alpha 1 minus alpha 2 minus alpha b. So the restriction that the unconditional variances exist is that omega should be positive. If omega is not positive or if it is equal to zero, that means sigma square is undefined or it is equal to zero or negative, right? So the restriction on the of the Garth model is that omega must be positive and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, this must be greater than is equal to 0 but less than 1. Why? So if some alpha are greater than 1, that means the denominator will be negative. In that case, your variance will become negative. The unconditional variance will become negative. Or another thing is that even if you are considering the conditional variance, if omega is not positive and of all alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, if all are zero, that means your sigma t square is also zero. That means conditional variance, but conditional variance is also a variance. It cannot be zero or negative. It must be positive. So the restriction on these parameters are omega must be strictly positive and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, these are greater than is equal to 0 but less than 1. And another restriction is that alpha 1 plus alpha 2 plus alpha p, so summation alpha I should be less than 1 such that your unconditional variance will exist. Okay, so given the formula of unconditional variance, the restriction of on the parameters are omega should be strictly greater than 0 and alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, these are greater than 0 but less than 1. And alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, summation of alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha p, this must be less than 1. If this is the summation is greater than 1, that means you will have a negative variance which is not allowed. So in case of Garth model, you have certain restriction on the parameters. So whenever you will maximize the likelihood function to compute the parameter, it will be a constant optimization procedure. It will not be an unconstant optimization procedure. So the two major limitation in case of Garth model is that one is it cannot capture the asymmetric variance or leverage effect. That means negative shock creates more volatility. That is not captured through simple Arch or Garth model. Another restriction is that it is a constant optimization procedure. You have certain constant on the parameter. Now to overcome this model, to these problems, we have other model. So one important model is called GJR Garth model. This GJR stands for Gluskin, Jagannathan and Rankel, three authors given one model in 1993, where they have addressed the issue of asymmetric volatility. That means if there is a negative shock in the market, your expected return is more than the actual return. That means your expectation was high but you are getting less actually. So in that case, you have a negative return, and in that case, investor reaction will be such that the volatility will be higher compared to the positive shock. So this issue can be addressed by this equation, and the equation and the model, corresponding model, is called GJR Garth model or threshold Garth model, where you have some coefficient. So this part is summation alpha p epsilon t minus p square. This is called, I am at page number 19, and look at the equation number 2.7.29. Here this alpha p into alpha p into epsilon t minus p square, this part is the simple arch part, this is the guards part, this part is the guards part, and you have some threshold thing, that means you have some threshold. So summation of gamma zero into summation of gamma into epsilon t, gamma zero into epsilon t minus o square, so into some indicator function. So in this indicator function will take value 1 if there is a negative shock, and this indicator function will take 0 value if there is a positive shock. So that means essentially, if there is a positive shock, then sigma t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 into epsilon t minus 1 square plus beta 1 into epsilon t minus 1 sigma t minus 1 square if there is a positive shock, and if there is a negative shock, it will be summation of alpha 1 into gamma 1 into alpha 1 plus gamma 1 into epsilon t minus 1. So the contribution of the previous shock in case of positive shock is only alpha p, and in case of negative shock it is alpha p plus gamma o. Or for T-Guard 111 model, the contribution of the past shock will be alpha 1 plus gamma 1 in case of negative shock, and only alpha 1 in case of a positive shock. So if your gamma is positive, that means there is a higher contribution of the past shock if there is a negative shock. So by this way, we can capture the asymmetric volatility, and this model is called threshold guards model. So by this threshold guards model, we are basically capturing the asymmetric volatility, which is some instinctive nature of the stock market or a high frequency time series, say macroeconomic time series also. Now here also we have some restriction on the parameters. I am not saying that in this case of GJR Guards model there is no parameter restriction. The parameter restrictions are omega should be greater than zero, and beta will be greater than zero, and the summation will be less than one. So in case of GJR Guards model also you have parameter restriction, but you have another model which is called exponential Guards model, given by Nelson in 1991. Here instead of modeling sigma t square, he has modeled log of sigma t square, where log of sigma t square is equal to omega plus this. Now you can see that as it is log of sigma t square, so if I want to calculate sigma t square, I will take e to the power of log of sigma t square. So even if log of sigma t square is negative, your sigma t square will be positive. So that means we do not need any parameter restriction to compute E-Guards model. So in case of E-Guards model, there is no parameter restriction. And finally, if we consider a simple E-Guards 1-1 model, you can see that if there is a positive shock, then your coefficient will be, your contribution of the shock to compute variance will be alpha 1 minus gamma 1, and in case of negative shock it will be alpha 1 plus gamma 1, where alpha 1 and gamma 1 are their absolute values. So here also we can see that E-Guards model is also addressing the issue of leverage effect. That means negative shock creates more volatility compared to the positive shock. Okay. So if you want to forecast, if you want to forecast the market risk, you can consider Gartz model. And if you have asymmetric volatility, then you can consider either GJR model or E-Gartz model. Hello? Hello? Any doubt? Yeah, any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay, so the estimation purpose, estimation method of estimation is given here. It is basically a maximum likelihood estimation for all model. So suppose RT is equal to mu T plus epsilon T and mu T, sorry, sigma T square is following any Gartz model, say maybe E Gartz, T Gartz or whatever. So you can accordingly write your volatility model. Now, whenever you will write your likelihood function, you will write 2 into sigma t square instead of sigma square. All other things are same as time series estimation. Here only thing is that instead of sigma square, we will put sigma t square to compute the likelihood function. And finally, we will maximize the likelihood function with respect to all these parameters involved in the conditional mean as well as parameter involved in the conditional variance. Now, after maximizing the likelihood function with certain numerical optimization method, we will get the estimated value of conditional mean parameter as well as conditional variance parameter. Now, once you have estimated the parameter, then you can forecast for the volatility of the next time period, right? So the forecasting is given here. So suppose it is following a simple R1 model. So sigma t square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 epsilon t minus 1 square. Now, at time period t, you have given epsilon t minus 1 square. That means all information up to t minus 1 is given to you. So if you want to forecast sigma t square, you can do it from these estimated coefficients. Now suppose you want to forecast sigma t plus 1 square, then sigma t plus 1 square is equal to omega plus alpha 1 into epsilon t. Suppose at time period t, all these informations are given, you can calculate sigma t plus 1 square. Now let you want to calculate epsilon sigma t plus 2 square. In that case, you can take expected value of this. Now put the value of expected value of sigma t plus 1 square, that is sigma t plus 1 square here. The final forecasting equation will be omega plus alpha 1 omega plus alpha 1 square into epsilon t square. So if you have the information up to t, you can forecast till h period ahead, right? You can forecast for future volatility. So the equation is given there. So the purpose of this model is to know to estimate the current risk as well as to estimate or to forecast the future risk, right? So here I am just discussing only for the R1 model, but some other models like Gartz model is also there. So you can just see the class note and the derivation to forecast for future volatility in case of Gartz model and T Gartz model. Now the question is, how do you know that there is volatility clustering, or how do you know that there is arch effect given the data? So given the data, you can first estimate a simple conditional mean equation, may be air model, maybe MA model, maybe ARMA model, or you can have some X variables as well. After doing this, you can estimate the error term. Now regress this error term on past p number of lag. Regress this squared error term on some p number of squared error term. Now in the equation given in page number 24, you can see that epsilon t hat squared is equal to theta 0 plus theta 1 epsilon t minus 1 square up to theta p epsilon t minus p square plus eta t. Now if alpha theta 1 sorry theta gamma sorry phi 1 phi 2 phi p if phi 1 phi 2 phi p are jointly zero, then we can say that there is no autocorrelation in the squared error term. That means there is no volatility. But if at least one coefficient is significant, then you can say that conditional variants are autoregressive. That means there is Arch model. So to do this, we will compute some Lagrange multiplier test, and the test statistics is equal to T into capital R square, where T is the total number of observation and R square is what? R square is the goodness of fit or multiple correlation coefficient of this equation, of this particular equation, equation number 7.75. So from this auxiliary regression, if we see that R square is high such that T into R square is high and it is statistically significant, then we can say that volatility or the conditional variances are autoregressive. That means there is Arch effect. And if your null hypothesis is rejected, if your null hypothesis cannot be rejected, then you can say that there is no time varying volatility. So your time varying, your volatility will be, your variance will be fixed for all time. Okay. So for Garth model, we can check whether there is a Garth model or not by using this formula, or by using this test is called Arch LM test. Now once you will find out that there is Garth model, you have to go for specification, maybe Arch model or Garth model or T Garth or E Garth model, depending on whether you have say asymmetric volatility or not. Now after this Garth model, you have another important thing which is called Rick's return relationship or Garchin mean model. So sometime we can see that my return from a particular asset is not only depending on the past return or some other variable, it may also depending on the risk associated with the asset, right? So if RT is a stock return and this RT can be written as mu, where mu is a constant, plus delta into sigma t square, where sigma t is the underlying risk at time period t. So if I incorporate the risk in the return equation, that means I am saying that return is also determined by the underlying risk. Then this model is called Garchin mean model. So sometime we are saying that more risk is associated with more return. If you take some risk, then you will have more return. That means whenever you are taking some risk, you are asking some higher return as a risk premium. So delta into sigma t square, this term is called the risk premium, where delta is called risk aversion coefficient. So to see the risk return relationship of an asset, or to see the inflation and inflation uncertainty of a macroeconomics, we can consider Garchin mean model. So if you look into the financial economics literature, we are saying that risks and returns are positively related. That means if there is a higher risk, investors will ask for higher return as a price of risk, because if investors are pricing the risk, so to hold the risky asset, they are claiming some higher return, and this is called risk premium. Similarly, for inflation also, you can have some hypothesis called Friedman-Ball hypothesis, which says that inflation uncertainty increases inflation. So in that case, we can consider Garchin mean model to see the risk return relationship.
Sir, actually, we couldn't hear that last part. The connection was not clear.
Okay. So I am repeating it again. So sometime in financial market or in macroeconomics, you are interested to see the relationship between risk and return. You may heard about it. In case of financial market, we are saying that there is higher return when there is higher risk, right? Or if you go to the macroeconomics, you can say that higher uncertainty of inflation increases inflation level. That means if you have high inflation uncertainty, then in the next period you have more inflation. Inflation uncertainty increases inflation. Similarly, risk of some stock market increases, risk of some asset increases the return. Why? As a price of taking risk. Okay. So in that case, if we want to look into the risk return relationship of the financial market, or in case of macroeconomics, we can use Garchin mean model, where the volatility is incorporated in the conditional mean equation. Now, if delta is positive, you can say that if delta is positive, you can say that risk return relationship is positive. If delta is negative, then you can say that risk return relationship is negative. So there are two types of interpretation. If delta is positive, then you can say that it is following the stock market is following capital asset pricing model, which says that higher the risk, higher will be the return, because investors will ask excess return to take the risk. But if the delta is negative, and in financial economics also there are certain another justification for the negative delta coefficient, which is called the volatility feedback hypothesis. That means if volatility is very high of a particular asset, investor will disinvest from this particular asset. They will take the money, they will withdraw the money, and accordingly, price of this demand of that particular asset will fall. So price of that particular asset will fall. So return will be less. And if return is less, from the volatility feedback, from the leverage effect hypothesis, your volatility will be very high again in the next period, right? So there will be some positive interpretation for the positive delta, and there is some interpretation for the negative delta as well. So whatever be the value of sign of delta, if you want to see the risk return relationship, you can consider Garchin mean model. Okay. So the estimation procedure for any kind of Garch model is same as univariate ARMA modeling, where the only difference is that in case of ARMA modeling, we have taken sigma square, which was fixed for all time. Here in case of Garch model, we have time varying variance, we will put sigma t square in the likelihood equation. and then we will maximize the likelihood function with respect to all these parameter set. Okay. Now, say suppose empirically, suppose you have some financial data, say maybe stock market data, maybe some say bond market data, or maybe inflation, or say GDP. You want to see the volatility of GDP, or it is called output uncertainty. So if you want to see the volatility, or if you want to measure risk or uncertainty, you can take Gartz model, and by estimating Gartz model, you can estimate the risk of a particular of a market, of the financial market or high frequency macroeconomic data. You can forecast the volatility or forecast future risk or future uncertainty. You can see the risk return relationship by taking Gartz in mean type of model, maybe Gartz in mean or E-Gartz in mean, T-Gartz in mean, whatever you want. So this is basically the purpose of volatility modeling. So in the dissertation, if you want to do some volatility modeling, you have to follow, say, your hypothesis may be whether there is leverage effect or not, whether there is say volatility feedback, the stock market is following volatility feedback hypothesis or capital asset pricing model hypothesis, and so on. That things you can check by taking financial data, or you can, in case of macroeconomics, you can see whether inflation uncertainty relationship holds or not. That is called Friedman's hypothesis. So that kind of analysis you can do using Gartz model. Okay, so yeah. Can you tell me how can I stop the recording? Do you have any idea? Yes, hello.
Yes.
How can I stop the recording?
Sir, I think that's the bottom to stop.
Record. I'm not seeing the button of recording, so that is the problem. Stop recording, yeah.